You shared your observation that many of the companies tend to go with like-minded individuals when promoting or bringing in new people. How does society begin to get the corporate structure to look at accepting people who tend to think differently or may have some of those new ideas that are so sorely needed?
Yeah, part of the dialogue needs to open up with CEOs and their boards about the continuation of the philosophy that if you get along with each other and that you all like each other, that's an important criterion. As a new CEO, you get contacted a lot as to whether or not you want to join boards of other companies. And I've been talked to by Korn Ferry and Heidrick and so on, and I've looked at and talked about a variety of positions. And they always start with, one of the critical first tests, of course, is going to be how well do you get along with the CEO? How well do you get along with the lead director if it's, you know, or a chairman if it's split? How well do you fit into the board dynamics? We've got to talk about that. I mean, that's, you know, many of you all here from the HR community, and we need to have a conversation among ourselves about, you know, how far can we push this definition of comfort and ability to fit within the team. But I will tell you that it occurs far too often in too many job recs that I see that are passed up to me that's an important part of the consideration. And I understand you can go too far, just before anybody asks. Yes, you can go too far in the other direction. You have totally dysfunctional teams. They can't get along. But our tolerance for disagreement has just got to increase in this country and in our companies.
Mr. Camden, you have brought us, in my view, two fascinating but really quite different issues, one being what I might call diversity at the top, and the other being inclusiveness of our society. And I'm going to smile a little and say for the first one, I'm not going to worry about it very much, because I think people like you will point out to our wonderfully diverse country the tremendous value of innovation and creativity and diversity of viewpoint at the upper reaches of companies, and those companies will, as a matter of direct self-interest, move in the direction you're urging. It will be a matter of survival. It will happen. I congratulate you for being one of the first voices I've heard to speak on this level, on this point. But the second topic is one that's been with us for a long time, and that is a matter of broad political will, as you spoke, as you said, in the answer to the first question. And there I have much apprehension for my country, and I welcome your voice to what I hope will become a very large debate, which will ultimately look to our national self-interest broadly construed. Because there, I wonder how you think we are going to assemble the political will to not leave a whole class behind, a whole sector of our society becoming a have-not society, where it's hard to make the leap into the successful, more economically successful sector. And I wonder if you have begun to think of what rhetoric it is that will drive home this point, that we cannot afford to become two Americas, to use one of the political phrases that's around today.
I spend a lot of time thinking about it, and I would argue that it's probably in the enlightened self-interest of corporate America to weigh in very heavy on this issue also. For the first time in my tenure in the business world at Kelly, I've had customers now who are moving operations outside of the U.S. because, not to save money, but because of an insufficient lack of talent, not enough college graduates. Today I'm talking often to CEOs of my customers, and for the first time CEOs are generally seeing the access to talent as one of the top five, top six issues they need to deal with. And the answer to that, if we're going to answer the talent shortage that's inside the U.S., we can't perpetuate saying that 50% of the people, you don't get to go to school. Or if you go to school, we're going to send you to a substandard school. We've got to, if we choose to compete, if we're going to win as American enterprise, we have to win by widening the talent pool quickly. And I do believe that the country does respond to economic self-interest faster than it sometimes does to an issue of just doing the right thing. And I believe that the recognition inside many of our economic centers of gravity are coming to the point of view. Access to talent is one of our top issues, and the best way to address it is to broaden the inclusiveness in American society.
To promote international diversity, many corporations are now moving their corporate headquarters abroad. I believe GE Healthcare moved from Wisconsin to London. I think Halliburton moved from Texas to the Middle East. What do you think of that strategy for corporations in terms of promoting international diversity of their management?
Now, there's no end of strategies. A group of us who became CEOs around the same time have chatted, and one of the things that we started, that we've all talked about doing, and in fact I did this summer, was instead of moving headquarters, I moved myself and operated for June out of our European headquarters in Switzerland, and kind of switched the whole dynamic of where the headquarters had to be oriented to, and they had to adjust to the time zone because I wasn't going to get up at 3 to react to them and so on. And next year I'll probably do the same in our Asian headquarters. I think what's important is not the particular tactic as much as the increasing awareness that I see that we have to have that cultural acuity, we've got to have that global competence if we're going to compete. And I think companies will try a lot of different things, and as always, they'll work for different companies and not for others.
Mr. Kenyon, here. I'm Lee Walker. I really appreciate the insights you provided, this new paradigm of thought and experience. It's a new way for me to think about things. I have a lot to think about. In the past, we used affirmative action as a tool to pry open the door of opportunity. Do you see what's the government's role in trying to bring about this new desired state that we're trying to achieve?
I think there'll be a lot of debate as to what role the government plays or doesn't play. But what concerns me most is that if we open the door to opportunity and nobody can go in, we have failed as a society. We haven't talked about healthcare. We haven't, we've talked primarily chosen to talk about education, access. We haven't talked much about access to food or other forms of public assistance. But if we create a world where corporate leadership is 100% behind diversity, believes in providing all the opportunity we can, but social policy limits those who can walk through the door to those who are already members of the haves, we have failed. And so I'm a strong believer in the policies that we've had in the past that have created opportunity, but implicit in that was the assumption that there would always be people capable of taking advantage of the opportunity. When we don't graduate enough high school students out of our urban schools, we are not going to graduate enough from college, and we're not going to have enough people ready to walk through the doors. That, to me, is the core issue.
Mr. Camden, I was glad to hear you talk about access to college education because I think it's one of the most important factors in achieving meaningful diversity. My question deals with an approach of principle. It's been the practice that at some of the top universities, it's functionally free and access is remarkable and diversity is as close to a perfect practice as I think society has seen. And the other model that has been on the discussion has been Congress's recent proposal to sort of cap and down its spending and encourage those universities to spend more payouts so that you'll see a deeper diversity pool at other universities. Which of these two do you think has the most promise, especially bearing in mind that there's a school of thought that optimists would say you create the most facially talented, sort of raise this talented 10th and put them in positions from which they can be inspiring. Do you think it's better to go for small and concentrated doses of diversity, or should you spread it out among universities?
I'm not certain that I know. I'll argue a couple of things, though, quickly. Although I may not have sounded like it at points, I am at core a capitalist, so diversity of options and having several models out there and seeing which one works is always the best way to deal with much of this. I visited, I've been visiting colleges lately, and visited many of them who guarantee that if you're accepted, they'll come up with a way to for you to be able to pay for the school.